kindergarten classrooms to fifth grade classrooms and such into buildings. So again, as we have smaller primary grades come in, we can say we don't forecast having as many primary grades, kindergarten, first grade classroom needs in the upcoming 5 years. We see they're going to be needed more as fourth and fifth grade. So we do some adjustments with how we utilize our classrooms at that time. But what we do, the state provides us a student population trend. This is where the state takes a look at the last 5 years. And again, they look at the averages. And real quickly, so y'all can kind of understand how the numbers move for our school system. And from 2007 to 2008, we gained 1,720 students. 2008 to 2009, we gained 1,839 students. 2009-2010, we dropped to only 1,643 students. And then we had the year of the crash, which was 2010-11, where we only gained 1,353 students. Now this last year, we jumped back up to 1,616 students. So we saw those numbers slide back, but now we see a tick back up in our numbers. And the state average those in, they determine that we'll have on average 1,612 students over the next 5 years. So they take our current enrollment that we report last summer at 1,612 to come up with this next year, at 1,612 to the following year, and it's a very static number that they use in their plan for forecasting how many students we should expect to build classrooms for. And this is all used to what they call entitlement. This is how much need Forsyth County has for building classrooms. Therefore, they can gauge us against the 180 systems and how much funding they can assist us with in building new classrooms or renovation modifications, such as replacing roofs, replacing HVAC equipment, and those type modifications that we have to do.
So they take all of those years as an average?
They look at the last 5 years, they average them up. Right now, it's this last report.
So we had that bad year.
Yeah, that bad year, which at one point my numbers were growing about 2,122 was my big year, mm-hmm. where we're averaging mm-hmm. that means students.
We actually had 2 years where it went down, so really the 1,600 is not.
But that year 2010-11 where we only grew 1,340 students sunk my average. So now for the next 5 years I had to live with that in my forecast.
So we should have had more. We should have tried to recruit more students.
But over the course of, over the whole state, we probably everybody probably dropped a little bit at the same time as we did.
As you see with the Forbes reports and everything, we're the fastest growing county in Georgia.
The whole state, so.
I think we passed Gwinnett last year as far as number of students that we gained versus them.
So are we gaining?
We're gaining students.
Compared to. So like Fayetteville or Fayette County and stuff, or
are they
getting, how many students are they getting?
Oh no, they've been losing students. They actually, and if you had seen some of the news reports, they actually had to close four schools since last year. They saw their trend growing up. They had very positive numbers from the state. They built schools.
Well, they're building like crazy down there.
Well, they built schools for all these new students they were forecasting. And 4 or 5 years later, they found out they didn't have enough students to open the schools.
Okay. Wow. So, and so to finish up my question, are we the fastest growing school system in Georgia?
As far as numbers, I think we're right at the top with the number of students. That's hard to count because, like I said, Gwinnett County has a smaller percentage, probably more students. But of course, we're talking the school system with 150,000 students to our 30.
So we're kind of with Gwinnett, the two, or you say the top two of Gwinnett and Forsyth?
Fulton County and Forsyth would want the top two. I think Fulton County's got a speed right now.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So they're 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
Okay.
Interesting. So anyway, like I said, they use that projection to figure out how many students we need to build classrooms for. We go back to our current inventory. We spread all the students out. We do what's called closed organization. So we take all the students that the state is predicting that we'll have by the year 2018, and we place them at all the schools, we fill them up, and then basically wherever the remainder falls is where we start building new schools or looking at additions to increase our capacity. And so in closed organization we're working through right now, identified elementary school number 14, which we're gonna build down Martin Drive to South McFarland. And so we've already asked the state for funding for that school, so that project's slated to get started this next year. And already started to talk through architectural designs on that building. And that is designed to help relieve the overcrowding at Vickery Creek, Midway, Charlotte Point primarily. And then within there, there may be some other maneuvering.
So you feel like the state's treating Forsyth County fairly?
Yeah.
Compared to, I mean, talking about the numbers going up and down, and are we getting our fair share? Are y'all happy with what the state?
I can give you some of the numbers. The one thing that changed with the state legislature on how they fund projects, there used to be two classifications that we fell under. One is regular, and regular entitlement allows us to be funded equally based on our FTE gains or decreases and all that. So they take a look at all of our students enrolled and kind of compare our system to every other system based on the very fixed number of current enrollment. And we earn somewhere about 2% of that money out of the state's $200 million at the time. Then they had a formula which was set up for exceptional growth. And that's where they looked at systems that gained at least 65 students, or their growth percentage was some other factor. And then those school systems that qualified as exceptional growth got to go in there and split another $100 million of funding for new school construction. And we used to make a lot of money from the state on that program. Then with the whole thing with the QBE and trying to balance out the state funding to all systems, because systems that weren't growing did not get kind of that windfall from the exceptional growth. So they took that $100 million from the exceptional growth, they built it into the regular, so now that funding level's gone to $300 million. And now we qualify based on the same regular rules for that funding. But one time we were earning somewhere at about $9 to $11 million in state funding for exceptional growth, and earning about $4 to $5 million in regular. Mm-hmm. So we,
that's a little less,
huh? Yeah. Now instead of $4 million, we're earning $5.5 to $6 million maybe. Mm-hmm. You know, it's that $300 million number jump. Mm-hmm. So we have those things we work through with the state. But the key thing with our proposed organizations, we put all students out there, we figure out where to put the remainder. As I said, for elementary school, we've identified that we'll build elementary school number 14. We have about 325 students left over, which we're starting to move into Poole's Mill, which is an elementary school property that would, in the future, relieve Sawney, Matt Elementary, those communities on the west side. And right
how
now,
how long does it take to build the school once you get the approval for the funding?
Our process, as far as, you know, once we have the property in sight, takes us about 3 to 5 months to get through the architectural. We do a lot of prototypical design, so we usually have an architectural plan that's really site adaptable, so we can usually get started with those projects quicker. And that's the Brookwood, Whitlow, Hilly Mill, which I suppose we've done several times. So, and the actual construction period for elementary school is about 15 months, about 18 months for a middle school, and then about 2 years for a high school. Because high school is just so much more complex, and especially with sports fields and all those things added to the size of the project. So that's where we got to with elementary schools coming up in our plan. The state is going to fully fund 71 instructional units, as you would call classrooms, for the next elementary school. Then we get to middle schools, and basically the state says they expect us to have about 11,419 students in the year 2018. So what we've identified is that we'll build middle school number 10, which is on James Road. It was the former Whelan property down there on James Road near Union Hill. And then we've identified that what we're going to do is expand the Riverwatch and South Forsyth Middle School. So we're going to take their capacity from about 1,025 to about 1,400 students. Their facilities were designed with core capacity, and that's cafeteria, kitchen, media center, those type elements that can handle that population that's reaching the top of what those schools are capable of handling. So we planned the additions of Riverwatch and South, and then a new middle school down the southwest area. And that takes care of all my...
When's that slated?
The middle school will probably go out for funding requests next August, and we'll be able to start that project. Probably put in the early start, 11, start spring of 2015. Because again, we have a site, we have a plan that we know we'll work towards. And then for the high schools, the state predicts we'll have about 12,804 students. And we've again assigned all those out to fill all the schools to capacity and identify that we'll need high school number 7, which again will be a high school we're going to look for property in the southwest area of Forsyth County, down below Midway area in that region. That will relieve South Forsyth High School and West Forsyth High School. And then to take care of the overcrowding at Lambert, we had planned Lambert for an addition. It's about a 2021 classroom addition that we'll put on the front of Lambert and expand their facilities to handle capacity about 2,450, I think. And then we're going to do an addition to North Forsyth High School to take care of the overcrowding in that area of the county. Because again, right now we don't think we have enough students. We did a kind of preliminary run with students in the north area. That if we populated a East Forsyth High School site that we bought on Chatham Down Road, we would have about 1,500 students that we could open that school with. But unfortunately, it would take away so many students from North Forsyth High School, their capacity would drop to about 1,100. So it really swung the other way for North High School, and we don't want to operate a school with that few students in there. It's just not efficient. So we decided the problem with North Forsyth High School, number one, is this cafeteria and service facilities are inadequate for the size school it has become, as it has had several additions. So we're going to build a new cafeteria with a full food service court like we designed with Wes and Lambert, give them a little bit better service area. And about 20 classroom additions, including some vocational tech areas that we've identified through our planning.
And when will the additions be?
With all these projects, we'll probably get started in earnest 2015. And like, again, the timing of it's going to really depend on how much staff we can manage projects as they come out of the ground. We'll definitely be starting very quickly with new schools coming out of the ground. The high school number 7 will probably be a little later because part of what we'll have to do is procure property, go through all the site evaluation, sketch plan, all those fun things, and get that property assigned and approved by the state. Then we can begin the construction, and we'll be working on school design with that property as we're evaluating, and so we'll hopefully have a leg up to get that one coming off the drawing board pretty quickly.
So what's the plan for the interim?
The interim? We are doing a redistricting right now. We're trying to maximize the capacity we have. We have several schools, Brookwood, Sharon, and Johns Creek, all those we've seen reduction in their enrollment. So we felt we had some ability to do some redistricting and move the students from the higher overcapacity schools, primarily Midway, Davis Creek, are two of the key ones, to move them back into those schools where we had classroom space available and help us our timing with having to build more elementary schools at this time. So that's the key part for that. We are doing a redistricting for the Riverwatch South Middle, and it affects the Lakeside area because Lakeside has a little capacity for us to even out the overcapacity. All the schools will be at overcapacity when we do this, but right now Riverwatch is so lopsided. There are about 1,440 students right now. So we're going to take a lump of those students back over to South. It will overcrowd South Middle School. So to help put it back into balance, we're going to move some of those students at the north end of the South Middle School District to Lakeside. So that's current plan.
Okay.
plan that we're going with in our current draft of the redistricting. And again, that's to try to bring all those middle schools in that region. They'll probably all come in at the high 1,100s, 1,200 students for next year.
But in the high schools, there's no plan to do anything.
No high school, yeah.
High schools, so you just have to keep adding.
Again, this, our two most overcrowded schools will be South Forsyth High School, followed by Lambert. So we're going to try and move students from Lambert to South, just overcrowd South. West doesn't have any room where they'll be just as bad as Lambert, so the whole thing starts to fall apart as we move those. And with the new high school clearly in the plan, we felt it's better not to do anything with those right now. Try to put in the learning colleges, keep them look until we get a new high school.
But the actual, I guess what you call core facilities, the media center, the lunch room, all that has already been built to accommodate more students than what the school currently holds.
Yeah.
And so they're not, they are going to a learning cottage, but they're being serviced in those other areas, right. Is that correct?
Lambert, for instance, is designed to handle capacity up to 2,500. So when we originally planned Lambert back in 2007, built in 2009, its core facilities with the gym, cafeteria, media center, was designed to go with an addition up to 2,500 students. South Forsyth High School, I think, can go up to about 2,600 with their core facilities. South's kind of lucky because they have two cafeterias which we're able to pull together to service those children.
So you would say that the students, the class size is not because of overcrowding of our schools?
No. The class sizes are all determined by the allotments, and that's all human resource with principals.
Because we're going to put in the cottages.
We're putting in the classrooms to handle
as
classrooms.
Many as they want.
And of course, some of the things they work with is to increase class sizes, and it's one of those things that's such a mystical formula to me, because as you look at what the teacher's allotment is, you have to remember that's 4 out of 6 periods in a high school that those teachers are handling students, as you look at the averaging of those students across the board.
Okay.
For their class size and their body.
And even though we saw growth all the way through this whole recession and everything, because we've been growing, we haven't ever lost students or not had any growth at all. So even though we've done that, we've seen that throughout, it was already projected we'd be at least at where we are right now. So we knew that going into it. It was by design that we're in the situation we're in now.
We knew probably 2 years ago that we were going to exceed our capacity for high schools and middle schools come last year. So we knew that based on the Georgia DOE's recommended guidelines for how many students a school can handle, which is based on how many instructional units and their core facilities, that our high schools and middle schools were going to peak last year, and they did. So it's just a question of the timing for getting the local funding to go with the state funding to go forward with building.
But we have the funds to put in as many cottages as we need to hire the teachers that we need to teach these children and to have the smallest class size possible.
Right. That the portable classrooms come out of the regular maintenance and operation part of the funding, where projects such as building schools, we look at a capital funding project to build those. And let's see.
We got a couple areas to touch on. Do you finish up?
Well, and like I said, real quickly, just as far as our projects goes, I've kind of reviewed what our priority projects are from the elementary school, middle school, 2 middle school additions, high school, 2 high school additions, and just kind of touch base. As I said, we get into some of that with funding. Currently, after this year, we have about $59 million in entitled fundings at the state, so we can begin drawing on those. We have the local funds to match with that to go forward. And right now, we've identified roughly that we've got enough projects to use about 50 million of the 59 million in our entitlement funding to the state. So starting next year, as we plan to have local funding, because we have to guarantee state that we can make our half match with their part. And so hopefully next year, we'll start submitting those applications in for the additional school projects. And all the ones that I've reviewed do qualify for state funding.
Do we have any two-story schools? Any of them?
Yeah. Yes. We started building two-story elementary schools, but Sharon Elementary was our first one. And we did that about three times with the Sharon design. We did Sharon, Shiloh, and Johns Creek. And then we did Hall Creek as a new version of that we built one time. And then we went to a two-story middle school, starting with, I guess it was Piney Grove first, Little Mill, and Lakeside. So we have three middle schools. And then the last two high schools, which were our first two high schools we designed.
West and Lambert, both
two stories.
Are those schools designed so that they can have another story as an addition?
No. Structurally, you know, the steel and girders that hold the building up aren't designed to go up another floor. Usually very cumbersome. A lot of our systems, which operate off the rooftops, of course, would be disturbed by trying to go up another floor and trying to worry about the safety and protection of students in a work area below. So most of our additions we plan as wing additions to the schools. So Lambert, we designed the front right-hand wing. And if you ever notice, at Lambert, you drive in to see that area's been cleared, and it's a wide open path. In fact, we move all the street lights and all that away from the building. So we can go in there and make sure we're not sitting on sewer lines, gas lines, anything like that. But we already have that pad designed for that addition.
And you didn't put in, you didn't build it out to capacity at the time you built it, because you didn't know for sure that we were going to grow that big, or?
Well, one of the things that's part of our local facility plan is called the tabulation of justification and explanation of the spaces we have to provide to them. We've been working on the plan that our high schools would never exceed 2,100 students. And that number purely came about with Central High School, when the old Otwell campus became the West Campus, gave them enough classrooms to earn 2,100 FTE for that campus. So we used that as our benchmark to say, that's as big as we want high school. We were leery about going into the 3,000 student schools that you hear about, because it become a real concern for security and knowing your students well enough and being able to do that. So we feel like we've had a chance to work with schools when we get to 2,500 student population, feel that we comfortably know who our students are, what they're up to, and look at those type of things. So the board is, with this plan, we'll be reviewing and approving for us to build schools up to 2,500 students for high schools, 1,500 for middle schools, and we're going to keep the elementary schools at 1,500. And again, elementary was based strictly on Sony Elementary and primary. We're again married into one school with a capacity of 1,425 students, so that's how we pick that number. But most of our schools are designed about 1,100 students.
So in the future, you will build to the 2,500?
The new high school is going to be built to 2,000 students with a plan for a 500 student addition to that school.
So you'll keep doing the additions.
Yeah, and the reason we decided to do that for high school number 7 was, if our population shifts on a post road more towards the west, I don't want to be sitting on 86 classrooms down on the southwest area without enough students in that area and then need more classrooms up by West High School. So by doing 2,000 at the new high school, gives me flexibility to add on to it, to add on to West, or to come back south and add on to it, so I have a little bit more flexibility.
Has the school system already purchased property for future schools?
We purchased property for elementary school 14 on Martin Drive, middle school number 10 on James. We have a property for elementary school number 10 on Waltrip Road, which will relieve someday between Chesapeake and Chattahoochee. Once upon a time, we saw those numbers heading up. They leveled off, postponing the need for that school. We have Cools Mill, which we bought a while back, with the idea that we would need to relieve Matt and Sawney. When we built Silver City, we actually took some students back out of Matt into Silver City, which then meant I had to reset the clock for Cools Mill. I think that covers, we have a property that was donated at the Reading development, so we have 40 acres up there for a school site, and we have the East Side High School site we bought. Again, looking at where the numbers with North were going. When we built and opened Lambert High School and dropped our populations both South and Lambert were down below 2,000, like about 1,700 students when we opened those schools. That left North as our biggest, fastest growing, my fastest growing, big school in that area. And with trends we saw, and a lot of concern, because we saw a lot of rezoning development in that setting down Creek Basin. Once the sewer came up through there, there was a lot of zoning in Coal Mountain back. So that was one of the things we do look at, where the development's planned for and how fast it's coming.
When did you say that zoning? When, that was in the 4th District.
The
Coal Mountain.
Coal Mountain back. Yeah, those are the north-northwest area.
When did y'all see that?
That was happening when the set down Creek Sewer.
Oh, okay, that was my bad. Can I ask a couple of questions?
Sure.
Okay. How much control do y'all have of traffic, the school board?
Traffic? Very little as far as, except what's on our campus.
Okay. So who controls traffic? Is it the planning department, the county, or is it the state does most of it, or is it?
What do you mean when you say traffic?
The big thing that we're hearing about a lot is a whole bunch of problems with traffic, people complaining about it. Mm-hmm. And who can affect traffic? The school board can't. I mean, you just said that. Except on campus.
But Jerry, why don't you finish with him, because he probably needs to go if you had other questions.
Well, I don't know why I'm being rushed. I mean, we had a lot of questions over here, and I've only asked one.
I'm just saying, you went from him over here, and I just thought, well, maybe you could.
Okay, well, you tell me who controls traffic.
They don't.
I know. So now I'm going to ask him,
okay,
who controls the traffic? You don't want me talking to Tom, so I'll talk to
him. Just trying to be polite.
I am too. But I've only asked one question. I don't have to ask any questions.
You have to break it down to a finer level to answer your question. Who controls road projects? That's a different question.
Yeah.
Traffic, lots of things play into traffic.
Yeah, it's not the school system.
I think some people have a different opinion on that.
Yeah, like I said, we have an impact.
You don't control it. You have impact, but you don't control it.
Yeah.
And, once upon a time, before I got involved with planning, a lot of schools were built right up on the roadway, very short driveways.
Mm-hmm.
So, of course, one of the things we tried to incorporate with our designs, we create the queuing lanes where you actually weave in and out through the parking lots to create as much stacking on our campus as we can.
Yeah.
So we tried to do that to get as many cars off the street during arrival and dismissal times.
Right. I understand that.
Try to encourage as many as they can to ride our buses if they would.
I wasn't trying to be rude. I didn't mean to be short. I was just saying, I've only asked one question and I'm starting to be limited.
Do you have some more questions?
Yes, that's what I said. Before y'all leave and asked some of your questions, I said, I've got two or three questions. You remember me saying that?
Yeah.
Okay, I've just got two or three questions.
Okay.
Question number two. This may be far out, but as it has to do with planning and zoning, a lot of people are moving. And that's my understanding. A lot of people move to Forsyth County for the great schools. And my hat's off to the school system for that. Well run, y'all do a good job. With that in mind, or some of our school, this SAT scores, I guess you judge schools on You have quite a few.
That's one of the benchmarks everybody looks at.
Okay, yeah. So, and I'm just going to make an assumption that in the south end of the county, their scores are higher than in the northern end of the county. I'm not casting dispersions on one or the other. I'm just geographically. Is that fair?
Yes. I mean, Lambert, southwest, all three of those came in.
People come up here to go to school there. And that has a lot to do with the planning and zoning and all that stuff that we're dealing with. Is there any way that the schools can kind of like do a, I know about Fayette County and what you were saying about that, you know, the old bill, but can you build it and they will come? Can you fix it so that the scores are higher in the...
Could we go build a Lambert up in the north end and see if everybody would come up?
Well, or transfer to the teachers up there, or in other words, get the scores up there, and then we can use that to disperse people throughout the county. That's the planning and zoning.
Yeah, unfortunately, we kind of have to go where the houses and the traffic is coming to. So if the traffic is coming to southeast Forsyth County...
So just the opposite of the build it and they'll come. Y'all come and then we'll follow in and try to take care of it. But y'all can't affect the school doesn't have. I know you don't, but I'm just wondering if.
I would hate to make that attempt to build a school up in northwest Forsyth County, see how many people want to drive from Highway 369, Mac Community, back to 400 to their jobs in Atlanta.
Yeah. But I'm talking about the quality, not the quality, but the.
Well, it does that we have basically the same quality at every school. Level teachers and the programs, you know, are all created under our academics accountability.
Yeah.
So the programs that they're teaching in schools is equal at all schools.
Yeah, I understand that. I respect that. But there's no way to do that. Think outside the box.
Like I said, we built a school up there. Like I said, in the north end of the county, and opened it, and we only had 1,000 students, and we needed 1,500 to make it operate properly, efficiently.
Okay.
I think we take a black eye on that.
Well, one more thing on that regard is that the, as you said, the public transportation part of it, the buses. I think that Forsyth County's bus usage is reasonably high compared to most other places. I think I read that. Is there, are y'all constantly working on trying to increase ridership in the buses so that it can relieve some of the traffic problems, or is the problem the parents wanting to bring their kids to school? But I understand the extracurricular stuff and all that other stuff.
So many of those factors come into play. The transportation, they have the programs of SOAR. They have some called advertisement awareness programs they try to have for bus ridership and all that to encourage ridership where we can.
Yeah.
But again, like I said,
do y'all feel like you're almost maxed out for what the students and parents will allow, or do you think there's room to get more people on the? I mean,
I would hope there's room to get more students on buses. I would hope green initiatives that people try to stay focused on, especially if we can work out with students, that is much more efficient and much more environmental friendly to have that many kids on the bus to ride versus that many more cars on the street.
Yeah, they would keep
and the traffic jams that you talk
okay.
about.
And the follow-up, this is my last question.
Well, and one thing I can tell you about the schools is about the bus ridership. No, I'm giving you some information about bus ridership. Is that the individual schools do their own programs to encourage the students to ride the bus, because for the schools, as far as administration and the teachers, they feel like it's better for their school if the kids ride the bus. And so they'll do if you ride the bus, you get a pencil, little giveaway type fun things for the kids, or make it a day of, you know, bus safety and the kids all do something fun. So they're, each individual school is also trying to help out with that.
So to follow up just right on that, does the school board have a PR department?
Yes.
Might I suggest that y'all do PR on? I think it would help the planning commission. I think it would help the board of commissioners and the school system to get a little PR campaign going on this traffic stuff. to educate the folks that are complaining about traffic and educate them as to what's really going on. You know, and if the school system can't do it, maybe the Board of Commissioners could do it. I call it PR. It'd be more of an education program, because I think there's a lot of misunderstanding about that. What do you think?
I mean, I think we, the school system does do some PR in terms of bus ridership and encouraging the parents, especially through the, I mean, it's not, I wouldn't say countywide in terms of for all citizens, but it's, if you're at the school, you know, if you have students at the school, mm-hmm. then you're getting constant yeah. communications about yeah. bus
well,
ridership.
Well, I'm talking about in general, and it's not a criticism at all. I'm just saying, I think it would help the two other parts of the county, the Board of Commissioners and planning.
And as Jayne touched base on, I mean, trying to handle a carpool line, you've got to have scouts way ahead of the line, figuring out which car is coming for which child by the time they get to that line, to have them lined up.
That's part of
education. It is quite a process to get this loaded up every day.
There's a lot of education that can be done to people that don't have kids in school, and you know, they're upset. I'm not criticizing,
you know,
I'm just
and
saying.
And the accountability of being able to count these kids as they go on the bus, and you know where those children yeah. are, and you, yeah.
and
you don't
and
have
I'm not them. Talking about just traffic, but I recognize the schools are the best in the states, maybe close to the best in the nation, so, but a little, that's a good time to do some good PRs when you're doing good, and I think it would benefit, maybe when you go back to the school board, it might, if you think about it, it might benefit other people.
And again, these are things that they constantly work on, trying to figure out ways to encourage ridership. They do pre-rides before school starts to teach kindergarten uh-huh. folks what to expect on your bus trip and teach parents.
Tell us about
it. Children will be safe when yeah. parents ride with them.
Yeah, well, I mean, I had an article in the paper about the buses, and I appreciate that. And then maybe you can kind of maybe start a column or something about the schools, and that's just to help us all out.
Isn't there some sort of a program of some kind about walkability with the sidewalks and bicycles? Yeah, yeah, that's mm-hmm. it.
There's a couple.
Yeah. The Georgia Department of Transportation did the Southlake Safe Routes to School program. It's actually a U.S. federally funded type program. Vickery Creek, for instance, has earned $500,000 to build and develop the sidewalk walk network, which basically goes from Dickerson Road through Post Road all the way back into Majors Road. With some of the work counties talked about extending that part of the project on over to the Greenway, so it actually connects Greenway back into the Vickery and Vickery Creek school areas.
Is there a timeline for that? Is it online on the website?
It was supposed to have been bid in July, and I think they've now bumped it back to December again, so it's one of those things we're just waiting for. It's a DOT funded and bid type project, so we have been waiting impatiently for a couple years now. But we have done other programs. We've worked on one with Selvis Ridge to look at how that community, as we put sidewalks in James Burgess Road, what communities, how can we tie those communities into that sidewalk and the sidewalk into the school buildings. So we have some of that, which we actually got some sidewalk projects mm-hmm. In our next funding project plan to connect James Burgess Road back into schools. Because Riverwatch was built back on the road there. And so they can walk down the bus driveway, but we prefer to keep them out of the roadway. They can walk to school.
I think I may have hit on something that maybe you, maybe the PR department can work something out with one of the papers around town. And I'm sure the paper would like to have it because it might help with their circulation. There's a little column once a week from the school, and this is what we're doing this week to help with this, or this is what we're doing with the traffic, this is what we're doing.
Forsyth County News is at all the board meetings, and they work real closely with our public relations person.
Well, I'm just saying that I know how newspapers work to some degree, and you write the articles for them, and you hand it to them. Especially if you want some publicity for your kid who's blocking for somebody on the football team. You can write an article and say,
So do all the high schools have to be built, with a football field, Or is that optional? Can they not share fields? How does that work?
The state doesn't require us to do anything except build the number of classrooms for the students. And, I mean, we don't even have to build that many parking spaces for all the students that come.
Booster clubs have a lot to do with some of that.
So we build the primary part with fields. And again, I think that's the expectation of the community. You know, as we started off with North Central South, and then those fields became very loaded as we built west. Once upon a time, those fields used to be shared with middle schools. We now have got such a proliferation of middle schools to high schools that that can't even happen schedule-wise, for the most part. So I think it's just an expectation from the communities that that is part of the community for Friday nights to have the stadium, to have the football. They're used constantly. If it's not football practice, it's lacrosse, it's soccer, it's the marching band. The whole gamut of folks use those field areas and stadiums for different events.
Do we ever consider any kind of, I don't want to say alternative school, but charter or magnet or some kind of a different style of a school that would attract different types of kids?
Those have been discussed. We've had some folks come in with private charters that have approached the county.
But not through the county as a public charter type. I don't know if it's a magnet or charter,
actually,
or how they do it.
Yeah, because actually Midway, once upon a time, was a charter school.
Okay.
So Dr. Dennis Whittle had done that with Midway and had it as a charter school.
There are other counties that have those schools, aren't there? Doesn't the CAF have
Yeah, like math and science type or foreign language or fine arts.
I think Fulton County or the city of
Atlanta. So we've had some discussions about doing some of those more specialized type of schools. Like I said, right now, with
there's no
space to handle all that right now is the question how to designate that school and understand how that would impact our enrollment and attendance populations at the other schools. I know one other project that's been discussed. Like I said, it's not my part to share because I don't understand enough about the charter schools. Like I said, we have evaluated some private schools, and of course, what we look for is that they have to bring something totally different to the table that we're not doing already. I know it's one of the measuring rods by how we review a private charter coming into the system.
So it wouldn't be feasible to do something, say, that would compete with the Central STEM program or the IB program at South, because we already have that?
Yeah, and see, we're getting those focuses at all of our high schools. So each high school will need to see more of this as it comes through the facility planning, and that part is to identify what's called the academy type project at each of schools. So each of them have a specialty. South High School is going to have a hospitality focus with the culinary arts program, so all that's tied together. The marketing program for West is going to expand more into sports marketing. It's going to be one of their special fields. We do have multiple engineering and STEM programs at the schools as well. Lambert High School is going to have health occupations. That's one of its focuses. So each of them are going to start to build a CTAE, career technology.
And the kids will be able to be added districted to those schools if they are in that program?
In those programs. That's the plan.
Anybody else have any more questions? Well, Tim, thank you so much.
You're
this
welcome.
Has been very helpful.
Y'all have me.
I never realized how much
detail
was put into this. I knew there was a lot. I just never realized it was that advanced, I guess.
There will be plenty more. If y'all just stay tuned to our website and board meetings, that we have the facility plan, the districting, and looking at our bond projects that we'll be looking at for all the schools to be developed over this next year.
That's great.
Thank you
so much.
Good presentation.